You're watching Tag TV.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin. It's been weeks since the first COVID vaccine shot was administered. Countries from the US to UK, China to India and Israel have launched their massive vaccination drives. However, the bigger challenge that has cropped up in such times is the hoarding of vaccines by rich countries. Billions of doses have already been pre-purchased, leaving poor countries at the mercy of God. India, which has been the top supplier of vaccines to all corners of the world, has urged countries to forego vaccine nationalism and embrace internationalism in such times.
COVID vaccine, the word that thrilled and satisfied the world a few weeks ago, has run into a global controversy over its inequitable access to the poorest of the countries. As per the data presented by the World Health Organization, around 75% of all vaccines administered so far have been in just 10 countries, while nearly 130 countries haven't administered any vaccines. The People's Vaccine Alliance, a group campaigning for free and fair distribution of vaccines, has given an even more worrying news. While the rich countries have pre-ordered enough doses to vaccinate their populations three times over, 9 in 10 people in nearly 70 poorer countries are unlikely to be vaccinated at all this year. WHO's COVAX program aims to inoculate all underprivileged across the world, but its speed will be dampened with rich countries resorting to vaccine nationalism.
The rollout of COVID-19 vaccines is generating hope. But at this critical moment, vaccine equity is the biggest moral test before the global community. We must ensure that everybody, everywhere, can be vaccinated as soon as possible.
Meanwhile, India, the frontrunner in fight against the COVID, which has also been vigorously and generously supplying vaccines around the world, has urged others to stop hoarding superfluous doses, for it believes that doing so will defeat the efforts toward attaining collective health security. Experts say vaccine hoarding and inequitable distribution could render a double whammy, as it will not only allow the infection to spread and kill, but it also set to give a $9.2 trillion jolt to world economy. As a dominant power in and around South Asia, and with the capacity to be the world's top maker of COVID-19 shots, India has gifted or sold more than 17 million doses to over 20 countries in past 4 weeks. Indian companies have promised to produce billions of COVID-19 shots this year alone. 50%, it says, will be shared with the rest of the world.
25 nations across the world have already received Made in India vaccines. 49 more countries will be supplied in the coming days, ranging from Europe, North America, Latin America, the Caribbean, to Africa, Southeast Asia, and the Pacific Islands. Keeping in mind the UN peacekeepers who operate in such difficult circumstances, we would like to announce today a gift of 200,000 doses for them as well. We are working actively with Gavi, WHO, and ACT Accelerator. Our contribution has also supported the SARC COVID-19 Emergency Fund.
Even Pakistan, India's arch rival responsible for fomenting terror inside its territory, will be receiving 2.8 million India-made COVID vaccines through COVAX route. when countries and grouping are passing resolutions urging rich countries to not hoard, they have acknowledged and appreciated the role being played by India in global fight to eradicate the disease. Meanwhile, Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi urged neighbouring countries to consider sharing data on the effectiveness of COVID-19 vaccines and explore special visas for medics to move around the region during health emergencies.
The hopes of our region and the world are focused on rapid deployment of vaccines. In this too, we must maintain the same cooperative and collaborative spirit. Friends, over the past year, our health cooperation has already achieved so much.
India seeks the world community to double down on the efforts being made to control the spread of the pandemic. While it has been successful in bringing down the infection rate by 10 times in past 5 months, India, appropriately labelled as the pharmacy of the world, has been doing everything to live up to its reputation and the hopes the world has pinned on its calibre.
Moving on. An over 50% rise in the international crude oil prices in the last 4 months has triggered unprecedented surge in the petroleum prices across South Asia. From India to Afghanistan and Pakistan to Nepal, people have grown frustrated with the oil prices and are protesting on streets.
With the latest rise of rupees 2 in petrol prices, student unions in Himalayan nation, Nepal took to streets in Kathmandu and raised slogans against the caretaker Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli. They say petrol prices have gone up by 9 rupees in past few months. Not just Nepal, countries across South Asia, which are heavily dependent on petrol to meet their daily needs, are witnessing angry demonstrations. International crude oil prices have gone up by as much as 50% in last 4 months after petrol exporting countries rebounded to their pre-pandemic capacity. OPEC and its allies have also increased production cuts, triggering drop in the supply. Locals, however, in Nepal believe that the political parties are exploiting the situation and are filling their coffers for campaign purposes through petrol price rise.
Yo, asamvidhanik sarkarle चुनावको नाटक मञ्चन गरेर र चुनाव खर्च उठाउने जुओ गर्ने गलत उद्देश्यका साथ एक हप्तामा जनताको प्रत्यक्ष दैनिकीसँग प्रभाव गर्ने कुरा पेट्रोलियम पदार्थमा हप्तामा दुई पटक मूल्य वृद्धि गरेको छ.
People in Pakistan too have been hurt by the petroleum prices. They are accusing the government of incompetence for not being able to manage the crisis. Residents say they have suffered double whammy as an unprecedented inflation has already hit their pockets dearly.
पहले इतनी महंगाई हो गई है कि लोग जो है वो आटे दाल से और अपने बच्चों की पढ़ाई से और अब जो है महंगाई हो रही है फीस देने से लोग कासर हैं, बच्चे स्कूल नहीं जा रहे, घरों में गैस नहीं आ रही, बिजली की मुश्किल है. उसके ऊपर गवर्नमेंट ने एक और बम फेंक दिया है कि हमें पेट्रोल की महंगाई दे रही है. ये कौन सा तोहफा दे रही है गवर्नमेंट हमें? ये किस जुर्म की सजा मिल रही है हमें? क्या इसलिए कि हम तब्दीली चाहते थे? ये क्या तब्दीली हो रही है? ये तो आवाम मर जाएगी. इससे अच्छा कि गवर्नमेंट हमें वैसे ही मार दे, कोई चीज़ दे दे, हम खा के मर जाए. ये पेट्रोल दिन ब दिन महंगा हो रहा है. आप तो कहते थे कि महंगाई कम होगी, ये क्या महंगाई कम हो रही है? आवाम बहुत ज़्यादा परेशान है. आवाम क्या करे? आवाम तो बहुत ज़्यादा परेशान है. वज़ीर आलम साहब कुछ करें.
The petrol and diesel prices are deregulated in India, which means a surge in the international prices directly affects the companies and hence the consumer in the country. Country's major oil needs are met by imports. The government does have an option of reducing the tax it collects through petroleum, but experts say that will impact its revenue that has already suffered since the pandemic outbreak. In this case scenario, it only appears that people are going to suffer for some more time until the international market lowers its prices.
Moving on. While the success of Pakistani prime ministers have rigged up Kashmir issue in international community to secure their political careers, it is India that has been working vigorously to ensure peace and prosperity in the region. New Delhi has played a key role in the growth and employment the region has achieved in past 1.5 years. From successful elections to development projects, the state of Jammu and Kashmir is witnessing all. Recently, India's External Affairs Ministry took foreign diplomats to Kashmir to witness the first-hand account of the developments the region has witnessed.
A group of 24 envoys was in Kashmir this week to interact with locals and Kashmiri authorities in order to get a sense of the real situation at the ground, especially in the aftermath of amendment of Article 370 that changed the status of the region into a union territory. It was the third delegation of diplomats to visit since August 2019. The visit came at the heels of successful District Development Council elections held in the region a few weeks back. This visit was organized so that the diplomats could take first-hand experience of the development claims made by New Delhi. They spoke to local residents and discussed their responses to recent local elections and economic opportunities. They also met journalists and civil society groups in the region.
They asked pertinent questions, wanted to know the ground realities, and that was shared by them. Elected representatives from all political opinions and all political parties participated. Everybody spoke about their views and constructive suggestions. And I think that was very well received. And there was a lot of interest in collaboration with a lot of European countries to address some of our governance-related issues.
While Kashmir went through one of the toughest lockdowns owing to Pakistan-sponsored security threats post change in its political status, the locals have termed it a historical curve as the violence has significantly dropped in the region. The communication channels that receive security halts have been restored. 4G network has been restored in the region. The government of India has also said that it will return Jammu and Kashmir the status of a state very soon. New Delhi has reiterated its agenda of strengthening democratic institutions and empowering citizens of Kashmir by bringing the region to a national discourse of the country. The efforts were acknowledged by the diplomats who said New Delhi had been successful in establishing a more democratic setup at all levels.
What we are realizing, let's say so, is that all what was happening the last year and a little more months is that democracy took place here. Clearly, what we can identify is that the local actors in terms of politics took their places now at the levels of the district, at the level of the blocks, at the level of the tehsils. It's impressive.
The delegates were also briefed by officials of Indian Army in Jammu and Kashmir about the consistent ceasefire violations made by Pakistan. Rattled by India's political move, Pakistan has been consistently trying to hamper peace in the region. Lately, Pakistani army has targeted civilians to inflict a political pressure. The government of India, however, has been undeterred by all its nefarious agendas and has been countering it at all fronts. Its key focus is development of region and its people. New Delhi had envisaged over $15 billion, highest ever for Jammu and Kashmir last year. Capital expenditure has improved significantly in the region. The government says that region will have a robust infrastructure in coming months. While entire territory has been electrified, piped water connections to 100% households is just months away. The government is also set to rope in major Indian and international firms to invest in the region in order to employ the youths. The region is also set to get light metro network soon that many have already labelled as momentous development in Kashmiri history.
Moving on. Days, months and years have passed, but the fortunes of Gilgit-Baltistan haven't moved a single inch forward. State-backed discrimination, tottering infrastructure and unfulfilled poll promises continue to be the story of the region. Pakistan's government, which has illegally controlled this region for over seven decades, has in fact ensured that the people here do not get a life of peace and prosperity. It has created obstacles and fomented troubles. And while it has been drumming about Kashmiri rights across the world, Islamabad has always been the last to acknowledge and react to colossal sufferings that the people in this region are enduring on everyday basis.
If this is not throwing innocent lives in the jaws of death, then one only wonders what is. In the absence of an alternative route, scores of vehicles, including passenger buses and loaded trucks, traverse this deadly stretch in the illegally occupied Yasin district every day. But that hasn't been enough to knock off the sleeping authorities. Weeks have passed since a large dust mountain following heavy rainfall came down on this key regional road, cropping up a situation where large vehicles cannot pass the area without hours of struggle. Locals who have grown disillusioned with the Islamabad-appointed bureaucracy have come to terms with decades of discrimination, and in spite of that, they call it a crisis that demands immediate government intervention, but nobody seems to have cared.
यहाँ रोड का हालत बहुत ही खस्ता है. यहाँ यासीन के आवाम के लिए बहुत बड़े मसाइल के दरपेश है, क्योंकि यहाँ पे जितने भी ट्रक और बस इस बड़ी गाड़ियाँ जो आती है उनके लिए बहुत ही मसाइल होता है, और जो ट्रक गंदम बोरी लेकर आते हैं उनके लिए कई दफ़े यहाँ पे फंस चुके हैं, और गंदम की बोरी जो है यहाँ पर लग के फट चुके हैं. तो हम अहबाज बाला से हमारी पुरजोर अपील है कि इस रोड को कम से कम यहाँ कोई पुल सीसी पुल बनाने की कोशिश करें, और यहाँ ऊपर से पानी जब आती है तो कई दिनों तक रोड फंसता है और बहुत ही मसाइल दरपेश है.
दिस इज नॉट एन एक्सक्लूसिव इंसिडेंट ऑफ एपथी. द इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर एंड सर्विसेज इन द एंटायर रीजन आर करोडिंग. The government claims to have spent huge amounts in the development projects, but locals have termed it a lie. Locals say any amount that is sanctioned by the central government is solely for the projects that cater to the needs of Pakistan and not theirs. Their pleas are rejected and ridiculed. Even trivial works take weeks and months to complete.
ये इस साल डिजास्टर जो है ना हुआ है, सैलाब आ गया है, और ताहल ना मैनेजमेंट डिजास्टर की तरफ से कोई है, ना हुकाम-ए-बला की तरफ से कोई है, ना वक्त के MNA की तरफ से हमें रखो है, ये टोटली 4 घंटे का काम है। पिंडी से बस आती है, वो यहाँ से भोंड नहीं जाती है, वो ट्रक आता है, वो यहाँ घंटा घंटा लगा देते हैं, दूसरे ट्रैफिक के लिए ये मसले बनाते हैं।
Gilgit Baltistan is home to some of the most captivating natural sceneries on earth, and its serene landscapes have the potential of making it a tourist hotspot. But instead of tapping its potential to provide a better life to local residents, the successive Islamabad-backed administrations have only exploited the land, resources, and people of the region. Locals say even the politicians who have indigenous roots are dancing to the tunes of Islamabad as they are given a favorable treatment by the government for their shift in loyalties.
Next, we take you to India, where spring is on its way and people are all set to welcome it with much enthusiasm. To mark the preparations for its arrival, they recently observed Basant Panchami, an auspicious occasion celebrated 40 days before spring and is dedicated to Saraswati, the Hindu goddess of knowledge and wisdom.
Various states in India got soaked in the festival spirit of joy as they celebrated the most awaited festival of Basant Panchami. Celebrated on the 5th day of the bright half of the Hindu month of Magh, which usually falls in the month of late January or February, the festival also glorifies goddess Saraswati, who also symbolizes creative energy and power in all its form, including longing and love. On this occasion, devotees in the Indian temple towns of Varanasi and Haridwar took a holy dip in River Ganges. This year, due to the pandemic, less crowd was witnessed as compared to the previous years, when tens of thousands of devotees used to gather at the banks to offer prayers and take dips.
स्नान कोरोना काल में जो है अपने शरीर का जो है सुरक्षा के लिए मास्क वगैरह पहन करके लोग आ रहे हैं और अपनी सुरक्षा के लिए जो है गंगा स्नान में शारीरिक दूरी बना करके लोग रख रखे हैं।
On Basant Panchami, people wake up early in the morning, wear white, red or yellow clothes and a variety of sweets flavored with saffron are prepared and donated. In Kolkata city of West Bengal, devotees were seen worshipping goddess Saraswati to help them guide to the path full of knowledge. As per the Hindu beliefs, goddess Saraswati was born on this day and therefore many students keep fast on this day until they make offerings Pushpanjali or flowers to the goddess.
কোভিড প্রোটোকল মেনে মোটামুটি একই রাখা হয়েছে কারণ যারা সবাই ক্লাব মেম্বার তাদেরকেই বলা হয়েছে যারা আমরা ক্লাবের সব অনুষ্ঠানে একসাথে থাকি তাদেরকেই বলা হয়েছে এবং সব কিছু প্রোটোকল মেনটেন করে সবাই মাস্ক আমরা স্যানিটাইজারও রেখেছি আমাদের রাখা আছে ব্যবস্থা করি আমরা আয়োজন করেছি এবং দেখতেই পাচ্ছেন আপনারা চেয়ারগুলোও ফাঁকা ফাঁকা রাখা হয়েছে সবাই ডিস্টেন্স মেনটেন করেই বসেছে সেইগুলোই বলা হয়েছে
Hindu goddess Saraswati is depicted as seated on a lotus, riding a swan and holding a veena in her hands. Basant Panchami holds immense importance for students and artists and special prayers are held in schools and colleges on this day.
Such festivals reflect the amazing diversity and rich cultural tradition of India. What is even more mesmerizing is how the people here embrace this diversity. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.